Good morning. Hi. Today we're continuing our series on the parables. And I want to thank you all for coming out in the what we call the August slumber. That's the phrase we use in churchology. August is one of the lowest attendance month of the year. If I didn't have to preach this morning after my week and weekend, I'd be home too. But today we want to look at the parable that you just saw, a brief illustration of. And this, I'm calling this parable of the tax collector. And in this parable, there are some contrasts that Jesus lays for us. And I think these contrasts are important to explore because at the heart of them, they define for us what is the basis of relationship and acceptance with God. What is the basis in acceptance of relationship with God? So if you would, please turn with me to Luke chapter 18, verse 9. Luke chapter 18, verse 9. I see Susan's here. You made it back from Jersey. Susan was the coordinator for Jenna and Aaron, our own Jenna and Aaron. They got married this weekend down in Jersey. I see Crystal. It was a wonderful, wonderful wedding. Great, great, great venue. I stayed over. We had a picnic in the park. Had chicken wings and macaroni and cheese in the park. If you're there in Luke chapter 18, verse 9, we'll read our opening text in its totality. And the scripture says, he, meaning Jesus, also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous, and they treated others with contempt. Two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, God, I thank you that I am not like other men. Extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I get. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven. But he beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, Jesus says at the end of this parable, this man went down to his house justified. What man? This tax collector who beat his breast, who cried out to God for mercy. This man went down to his house justified rather than the other, the religious individual. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. Holy Spirit, we thank you now for the quickening and the enabling to communicate and to impart your truth. We ask that you would prepare and cultivate within the ears of the hearer the capacity to discern, to receive. We block out all distractions. We sanctify this moment, this time, for the instruction that comes from your word. We receive with meekness your engrafted word that is able to save, rescue, deliver, and make whole our souls. Lord, we shatter any mirror that will stand before us other than the mirror of your word and the reflection of our true heart. In Jesus' name, amen. So, what is the audience in this parable? Let's deconstruct this parable so that we can get down to the nitty-gritty of application. Because there are some fundamental, essential nuggets and truths that lay in this story for us. So, first of all, who is our audience? Luke 8:9 tells us that he told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and they had contempt for other people. So Jesus is telling this parable to those who think their stuff don't stink. He's telling this parable to those who would look down their nose at others, those who thought that maybe because they went to the right church, maybe because they were part of the right denomination, maybe because they didn't wear makeup when they grew up, maybe because they don't wear pants. He was telling this to people who thought that their righteousness came from something other than themselves, and in that it caused them to despise and have contempt for others that didn't meet up to their standards. He was speaking this to religious-minded individuals. Know anyone like that? Who are the characters in our story? Verse 10 says, two men went up into the temple to pray. One a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. So our characters are a Pharisee and a tax collector. The Pharisees, they were a very religious group. This particular gentleman belonged to a sect of Jews that went to unnecessary extremes in trying to obey the law. If God said don't go 10 feet within a dead animal, they made a rule that said don't go 100 feet within a dead animal. They kept the rules as much as they could. They made a lifestyle out of keeping the rules. They made rules to keep the rules. They made rules to keep the rules to keep the rules. They were very religious. In fact, Jesus once said to the Pharisees, he said, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the Pharisees, you shall in no wise enter heaven. In their day, the Pharisees in Jewish culture, they were the center of the community. They were the center of religious life. They were the ones that people looked to as a standard of what living and serving God looked like. Then there was the tax collector. The tax collector were basically legalized, sanctioned thieves. If you were a tax collector as a Jew, and we know he was a Jew because he went to the temple. Only Jews would go to the temple. But Jewish tax collectors worked for the Romans. The Romans were an occupying force and army. So this is a Jewish gentleman who's now working for the Gentiles. That's already a no-no in Jewish culture. Secondly, the way a taxpayer got paid, if he was a taxpayer for Lehigh County and he had to gather $2 million a year to give to Rome, if he gathered $4 million a year, the other two was his. He got paid by what extra he could make on top of what he was legally sanctioned to gather. So taxpayers were considered legal thieves. Not only were they legal thieves, but they were also working for the Romans. They were creating revenue for the Romans to continue their occupation and oppression of their fellow Jews. So they were despised of all people. Oftentimes in the scriptures, even when the disciples are writing their narratives in the gospel, you'll constantly find phrases such as this. And Jesus was with the Pharisees and the sinners. I mean, the taxpayers and the sinners. The taxpayers were so despised, they were considered a separate class above the sinners. You couldn't get any worse, any lower than being a tax collector. So in this parable, Jesus takes two characters that stand at polar opposites, two contrasting individuals. It would almost be as if you were trying to compare Mother Teresa and Miley Cyrus. You can't get any more polar opposites than these two individuals. And what is Jesus trying to convey? So he sets the stage that here's these two individuals that are going up to the temple to pray. They're going up to the temple to approach God and to engage God. So how do they approach God? Each man's prayer was different from the other. And it's instructive for us to consider what that prayer consisted of, because herein lies the essence of the parable. So if we look at Luke 18, verse 11 to 12, the scripture says this concerning the Pharisee and his prayer. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus. Some of your translations will say he prayed aloud. So he's in the temple and he's praying aloud. Remember what Jesus said in another gospel. He said, when you pray, go into your prayer closet and pray quietly and in secret. Because if your father hears you in secret, he will reward you openly. Remember, he specifically said, don't be like the Pharisees who pray out in the open to be heard. So here's this Pharisee who's going up into the temple, and he's standing in the temple, and he's putting on a show. Y'all have seen it in church, folks have to pray. They're supposed to do a 1 minute prayer or a 30-second prayer. Can you bless the food, brother? Lord, Father, we thank you. God, you provide you this chicken sacrifice, this life that we may live. Here's this Pharisee. He's standing in the middle of the temple, speaking out loud to be seen and heard. And watch what he says. He says, God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. Remember the reason Jesus presented the parable. It was for those who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. This Pharisee's prayer was exactly that. A self-serving attempt to tell and remind God of how righteous he was. To tell and remind God of all the good deeds that he did. Why he is so worthy and deserving to be standing there in the temple giving such an eloquent prayer to God for all to hear and to see. It reeked of his own vanity and ego. His prayer was focused on his works, not God, but him and his works. Look in this verse how many times we see the word I. I thank you that I'm not like other men. I fast twice a week. I give all that I get. He was self-righteous. He was focusing on himself. And the crazy thing is, even in the midst of all this, he had the nerve to throw some shade on the tax collector. He's supposed to be pouring his heart out to God. He's I, and I ain't like him. Not like him. Romans 4:5-8 tells us this. This is something that the Pharisee didn't understand. He thought that his efforts, his works, his keeping of the rules, his keeping of the law, his performance of religious duties, his performance of religious acts was the basis of how he could stand before God with confidence. Romans 5:4-8 says, when people work, their wages are not a gift, but something they've earned. But people are counted as righteous, not because of their work, but because of their faith in God who forgives sinners. This Pharisee, his approach to God, seen in his prayer, was, God, you owe me. Because remember, they were master rule keepers. I've kept all the rules. I've checked all the boxes, God. Therefore, you owe me. And it's my duty, Lord, to remind you of what you owe me. How do your prayers sound? But then when we look at this tax collector, this despised tax collector, this lowest of the low in Jewish culture and society, this tax collector who had a consciousness about God that even though he was doing his dirt, he still approached the temple. It says, but the tax collector standing how? Afar off. He's over in the corner by himself. And the text says that he would, look at these descriptors that tell us about his heart, his mindset, his attitude. He wouldn't even lift up his eyes. He's standing in the corner. Then it says he beat his breast. He's off in the corner. The Pharisee is in the middle of the courtyard praying loud to be seen and heard because he thought he had the right, that he had earned it. Here's this tax collector over in the corner somewhere, bowed down, burdened by the weight of his sin. He can't even lift his eyes up to God. He knows he's dirty. He knows he's shameful. He knows he's broken. And the Bible says he beat his breast. And in the Greek, that word beat his breast, in the Greek tense, it means he repeatedly beat on his breast. Maybe this tax collector, maybe his attitude towards God was, I know I'm foul. I know I've done some messed up stuff, man, but Lord, I can't help myself. God, I see the stuff that I'm doing, and I'm not happy even with myself. God, how can I stop? And he beats his breast. He makes no excuses, no attempts to justify himself. Then he utters these seven powerful words. God, have mercy on me, a sinner. The Pharisee standing in the courtyard, standing to embellish in front of everybody else, he looks and he compares himself to the tax collector and says, I'm not like him. This tax collector, he has one focus in his prayer. His focus in that prayer is the sovereignty and righteousness of God. And he realizes that even in his own actions, there's no way that he can appropriately approach God unless there's mercy, unless there's grace. And he acknowledges and he confesses before God, God, have mercy. I didn't keep the rules. I didn't do it right. I didn't follow all the list. I skipped some steps. I did some dirt that I knew I shouldn't have, but I did it anyway. And I'm not making any excuses for it. All I'm asking for, God, is for some mercy. That's how he approaches God. He comes and he says, has mercy on me, a sinner. It's nobody else. Remember the old song? It's me, it's me, it's me, O Lord. Standing in the need of prayer. Not my brother, not my sister, but it's me, O Lord. Standing in the need of prayer. The indicator of when we have allowed a spirit of a Pharisee to come and infect our heart is when we are constantly focusing on the deficiencies of others. You know folk like that. It's always about what others ain't doing, how others ain't right. Remember what Jesus said? He said, well, listen, if you're going to move that splinter out of your brother or sister's eye, what first must you do? You got to remove the plank, the big 2x4. So you got to, you worried about someone else's splinter and you got this big 2x4 stuck in your eye, but you can't see it because you got that pharisaical spirit. You want to make sure everybody else is keeping the rules but you. This tax collector, he comes before God. He recognizes, he admits that he's broken. And I love that word, he stood afar off. Because Ephesians tells us that we are brought nigh by the blood of Christ, that sin separates us from God. And his consciousness of his sin was reflected in the fact that he stood far off from everything around him. And he understood that his only means of approaching God, he was dependent upon mercy. He was asking God to forgive him. One thing he understood that the Pharisee didn't understand. Our approach to God is on the basis of his mercy, not our works, not our effort. And righteousness, doesn't matter how long you've been in church, doesn't matter what title you were, you know, the one thing, I'll leave it alone. Okay. Because it's just, this is my pet peeve. I ain't got Bible for this. This is just my pet peeve, right? And my years of being a Christian, and this is always, at least for me, in my mind, indicative of a pharisaical spirit. When people walk up to you and they introduce you by their title in the church. Oh, I'm pastor so-and-so. I'm reverend this. I'm evangelist this, this, this. I'm deacon this, this, and this, and this. What is the purpose of that? No. What is the purpose of? What are they trying to convey? They want their title, right? I ain't like the rest. I tithe. I fast. I'm spiritual. See my title?
Go ahead,
Pat.
Tell
him. Collars. Come on. When I was a young Baptist minister, I got in trouble because I asked a question. And the question I asked was simple in my mind. I wasn't trying to stir up nothing. I said, why we got to wear a robe? I was about to do my trial sermon. I was making $5.50 an hour. I had a wife and four kids. I couldn't afford a robe. So I wanted to know why I got to spend money for something I can't afford. I don't see it in the Bible. Right? But all, listen, all of these elements and all of these things are part of the religious mindset, and they're part of the things that we do and incorporate in our construct of faith that causes us to feel as if we have the right to approach God. That we can feel more comfortable coming to God because of what we've done and how we've done it and the rules and the order that we followed. That's the Pharisee. The tax collector came naked and bare. All he presented was the brokenness of his own heart over his sin, symbolized by the beating of his breast. Jesus said this. After they're done praying, they both leave the temple. And in verse 14, Jesus says, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified. What man? The tax collector. The tax collector went down to his house justified rather than the other, rather than the Pharisee. The tax collector is the one who received justification from God. Not the religious cat, not the cat with the collar and the robe and did everything right and checked all the boxes. Not him, because he was standing in his own works. It was the sinner that left with the acceptance and the justification of God. Why? He says, for everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. Everyone that exalts themselves. So when you present yourself to somebody, hi, my name is Pastor Dave Jones. What am I doing? I'm exalting myself. That ain't my name. My name is David Scott Jones. That's what my mama named me. That's what's on my birth certificate. That's my name. Ask me what I do. I'm a pastor at New Vision. But that's not my name. It's not my name. I've never forced anybody to call me by a title. And I give you scripture. I could give you scripture for that. But we ain't got time for all that. So the tax collector was not justified by any of the deeds of the law, but by his repentant, humble approach before God, by his acknowledgement of sin, and by his faith in God demonstrated by calling upon his mercy for forgiveness. The tax collector stood realizing there was one central component that he needed from God: mercy, grace, to cover and to make up the difference for his sin and his brokenness. The Pharisee thought he was good in and of himself. He never once asked of God mercy, never once asked of God for grace, never once acknowledged any of his deficiency whatsoever. The point of this is this, in our application, that both men are sinners. The Pharisee doesn't know he's a sinner because he only trusts in himself. The tax collector knows it and throws himself on God's mercy. See, you cannot be saved until you realize you are a sinner. This is why I make the emphasis that I do about the altar calls and all of that. Listen, hear my heart. None of it means anything if that person isn't recognizing I'm a sinner. I'm not coming because I need God to fix my marriage. I'm not coming because I need God to give me a job. I'm not coming because the doctor gave me a bad report and I want God to heal me. That's not the basis of salvation. The basis of salvation is the recognition I am a sinner. I am in need of God's redemptive atoning work in Christ. And for many people, that's the hardest step to take. To admit, to confess, to be like that tax collector. Beat their breast and say, have mercy on me, God, a sinner. Because we live in this moral equivalency in our society. And we're like the Pharisee, always looking for a tax collector. Always looking for somebody who we can boast our chest out before God and say, see, I'm not like them. See, God, I don't get high anymore, God. I don't lay and sleep around anymore, God. I don't lie, cheat, and steal anymore, God. I ain't laid out drunk anymore, God. I ain't like them. The The ideal here is to come to the point of recognition that we're all sinners. And that the way that we approach God is from a standpoint of brokenness and need, not from the standpoint of I got it all together. God, let me get ahead of myself. Romans 3:10 tells us this. What then? Are we Jews any better off? No, not at all. For we have already charged, in other words, we've already declared that all, both Jews and Greeks, in other words, those who had a relationship with God and those that don't have a relationship with God, that we are all under sin. All under sin. And as it is written, none is righteous. No, not one. This verse was taken out of the book of Isaiah. And I wonder if that tax collector, as he was having his Jewish upbringing as a young child, I wonder if that verse stuck in his heart. And it was from that verse that he learned to approach God and to realize, I ain't right. Can't get right on my own. Can never really truly be right. See, as long as you and I are like the Pharisee and we compare ourselves to other men, we'll always think that we've arrived. Because you can always find somebody who on the outside appears to be in a worse situation than you, appears to have a little bit more dirt on their hands than you. Because people can't see our hearts. All of us are sinners. The Bible says there's none righteous, no, not one. There's a 3-year study of Christians that was recently done that showed that 57% believed that all people are sinful. This is a study of Christians. And 57%, which means 43% of Christians, don't believe that all people are sinful. Because y'all know, see, intellectually we hear that, we go, well, that's crazy, right? But how many times have we said to our unsaved loved ones and friends, oh, girl, you know you got a good heart. You just need to start coming to church because you got a good heart, right? That's what the 43% is saying. And the truth is that all of us are broken, deficient, and in need of God's grace. All of us. There's none righteous, no, not one. Only 1/3 of Christians admitted to making mistakes. Only 1/3 of Christians admitted to making mistakes. But those who made the mistakes, that 1/3, did not see themselves as sinful. Didn't see themselves as sinful. Because I'm a Christian. I keep the rules. I go to church. I go to the right church. We listen to the right music. We have the right order of service. Our pastor wears real pastor clothes. I can't be a sinner. I can't be a sinner. I want you to listen to this illustration. And this is a true story that I found. An evangelist, Eddie Martin, once conducted a crusade. At the altar call, a well-dressed woman came forward. It was Reverend Martin's custom to have them repeat the sinner's prayer with him. He took her hand and prayed, "Dear Lord, I know that I am a sinner. I know that I can't save myself. I need forgiveness for my awful sins. Please accept me, dear Jesus." That was the sinner's prayer he prayed with the woman. But as he prayed with the woman, she remained silent. He looked at her and asked, "Don't you want to be saved?" Her reply was a sincere and hearty, "Yes, I want to be saved, but I am not a sinner." Then his reply to her was, "Then you can't be saved. Jesus only died for sinners." And her reply, "But Reverend Martin, I'm a good sinner." See, the focus of this parable, it isn't prayer. The focus of this parable is what constitutes salvation in relationship with God. One man thought that his righteous acts, his external religious duties and obligations, gave him an ability to approach God and there earn righteousness and acceptance. The other man knew he was a sinner, didn't try to hide it, was probably overcome. And again, it's so emphatic in the way that the Greek states, he beat his breast. It means continuously. He just beat his breast. And I bet it was like, man, I can't beat this thing. Man, I can't kick it. I remember when I first gave my heart to the Lord, I was in that crack house. That's exactly, God, I can't kick this. God, I can't beat this. God, I need your help. I bet that was his mindset. And the Bible says, because of that mindset, he was justified. In the conclusion of the parable, Christ reminded the audience that everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. We exalt ourselves when we act like we ain't never done dirt. When we act like our stuff don't stink. When we act like we're better than other people. When we walk around with this air of religiosity that just stinks when you walk in the room. You know it. You've seen them people. You've met them people. I used to be one of those people. You know it. As soon as they come around, you smell it. You see it. All this arrogance. Well, I don't go there. I'm a Christian. Well, I don't do that. I'm a Christian. Because in their minds, they're a Christian based upon what they do. Because they fast, they tithe, they're not like the tax collector. The tax collector was humble and was in a repentant frame of mind. He was the one justified. The Pharisee was not the humble one, but was proud. And look at the scripture says about those who are proud. 1 Peter 5:5. In the same way, you who are younger must accept the authority of the elders. That sounds good. In the same way, you who are younger must accept the authority of the elders. Young folk don't listen to the elders like they used to. And all of you, watch this, all of you dress yourselves in what? Humility as you relate to one another. Dress yourself, put on. That is a proactive step that you take. See, humility is something you have to choose to put on. And he says to put on humility, dress yourself in humility as you relate to one another. See, that Pharisee had no humility as it related to the tax collector. I'm better than you. I keep the rules. And the application for us is when we are truly humble, we don't look at those outside of the reach of God's redemptive grace and love in some way that we're better. We don't drive and walk and go by the communities that we once were in and on the corners we once hang on and go, he's still doing that? She's still, It's real talk, right? This is what you hear from people. It's real talk. Humility is first and foremost what is demonstrated towards others. Because watch what it says. For God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. This Pharisee was not justified because he refused to demonstrate humility towards the tax collector. And because of that, God resisted him. God opposed him. And that word oppose in the Greek is a military phrase. It gives a picture of when armies deploy themselves across a field for battle and set up in a defensive posture and stance. So God says when he sees pride and arrogance, he comes up against that. Why do you think that is? Why is it that God has this attitude and he is so oppositional? The God of love and mercy and grace who will embrace us in almost any other state but pride. Pride started to fall. Pride is why Satan fell. Pride is how sin began. Peter 5, 6 says, so humble yourselves under the mighty power of God. And at the right time, he will lift you up in honor. If you humble yourself, God will raise you up. You ain't got to go around puffing yourself up, conniving and scheming to try to get ahead, to try to get some visibility. God got you. Listen, whatever God has for you, nobody can take from you. Whatever God has, it kills me, it frustrates me, it weighs on my heart as a pastor when I see gifted men and women of God who they know and recognize they're called, but they try to produce the calling themselves. They try to get ahead themselves. They try to position themselves. And then when it doesn't happen the way they want it to happen, they want to blame others as keeping them from what God has. Listen, if God called you, can't nobody stop God from putting you where he wants you to be but you. Don't one monkey stop God's show. But if we humble ourselves, he'll lift us up. He'll exalt us in due time. James 4:6 says this again. He says, God gives grace generally, as the scripture says, God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. So what becomes the basis of God's acceptance? We end with this summary and conclusion. So this parable is not about prayer, but it's about salvation and the basis of how one approaches God to take hold and appropriate grace and mercy, which leads to redemption and salvation. Romans chapter 3, verse 20. For no one can ever be made right with God by doing what the law commands. The law simply shows us how sinful we are. No one can ever be made right with God by doing what the law commands. You can't, I can't gain acceptance with God by keeping the rules. Can't do it. You've heard me say this time and time again. Christianity is not about morality. Christianity is not a moral construct. If it was about morality and our ability to be moral as the goal, then Christ would have never needed to come and die on the cross, because it could have been attained ourselves. For our righteousness, our morality, our good works, our efforts, our best intents, the scripture says, are as filthy rags, good for nothing but to be thrown out and cast into the fire. It is not about your and my morality, because no one can ever be made right by keeping the rules. The law simply shows us how sinful we are. The law acts like a thermometer. It tells us the degree of sin in operation in our body, how wrong, how off the course we are, but it can never make you. Romans 3:21. But now, see, since the law can't make you right, but now God has shown us a way to be made right with him without keeping the requirements of the law. Ho, shut your mouth, preacher. Ho, slow your roll. God has made a way for us to be made right with him without keeping the requirements of the law. I can actually be made right with God without keeping the rules. Oh. Verse 22 and 23. Here's that way that you and I are able to approach God. That you and I, though we may be like that tax collector, that we may recognize that our hands are dirty, that we may recognize that there's sin in our heart, that what we think sometimes, what we say sometimes, how we respond sometimes, the things that we do, we are made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ. We are made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ. And this is true for everyone who believes, no matter who you are. For everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard. Everybody is deficient. Everybody is broken. Everybody is that tax collector. Everybody is afar off from God. And the only way we get to God, The only way we can have a relationship with God, the only way we can be accepted of God, the only way we can walk away justified by God is by placing our faith, our trust, our confidence, our reliance, our dependence, our adherence on Jesus and what he did on that cross. But we live in a day and age in the church where we don't preach Christ anymore. We don't preach the cross anymore. So people have nothing to hang their faith on but their own efforts and their own works. It's not enough just to believe Jesus lived. It's not enough just to believe Jesus died. Not enough just to believe that he rose again from the dead. I have to believe that all of those things are the sole basis of me being able to approach and be accepted by God. Because all of us fall short of God's glory. And in this verse, it defines for us what sin really is. What sin really is and why we are all sinners. Sin really is the fact that all of us on our best day can't measure up to God. Who can be like God? Every day, 24/7, in every thought, every intent, every response, every motive of the heart, every desire. Who can be like God 24/7, 365? That is the issue. That's why we're all sinners, because we can't be like him. The moral code and the moral standards, no, that just shows us how far off we are. We're sinners because we aren't like him. We were made in his image, but then sin came in the garden, and forever since then, we've been broken trying to get back to where God had originally made us. That's why we're all sinners. And that's why even after I come to the cross, I still have to have that disposition in my heart of the tax collector. That I'm still coming and I'm recognizing that, yes, I'm saved. Yeah, I've been walking with God 28 years. Yeah, I'm pastoring a church. This is my third church I've pastored in. But yet still, I got dirt on my hands. Still, my heart's not fully clean. Still, I have thoughts. I have responses. I have attitudes that aren't reflective of who God is all the time. And therefore, I'm constantly coming before God, not saying, well, Lord, I've been with you for 28 years. And I've pastored in some big churches. I've got some titles, and so you need to approach me like you know God. We got to be like that tax collector, because we recognize what the real standard is. It's him. None of us measure up. We're always going to be lacking, always in the need of grace, always in the need of mercy, always in the need of forgiveness. Verse 24. Watch what he says. He says, yes, God in his grace freely makes us right in his sight. Freely makes us right in his sight. That's important. That is important. Freely makes us right. Freely. 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 All you have to do is believe to receive. You ain't got to pay for it. It's already been paid. The Bible says that you and I were bought with a price, and that the precious blood of Jesus. So salvation, relationship with God, acceptance with God, being justified before God, dealing with my sin, obtaining God's mercy, which was the cry of the tax collector, it's free. All I have to do is believe and receive it. Believe that what Jesus did on that cross, man, that's it. And when he was buried and rose again, that was God's evidence that debt was paid. I've seen too many Christians come into Christianity and still think they have to pay the penalty for their debt. Still trying to earn what was freely given. It's like, I'll leave them. Now, here's an important part in this verse. It says, freely makes us right in his sight. In his sight. And I'm going to say something. You have to listen to me. You have to listen to all that I am going to say. My first 2 years as a Christian, man, I was up, down, in, out, over, and under. There were some days when I had the question, am I saved? because of my actions. I was still getting high. I'd be good for 3-4 months, then I'd be back getting high again, right? If I had listened to what people told me based upon what they saw in my actions, I would have believed that, now that salvation thing, it didn't stick, didn't stick, didn't stick. I go back for another shot because this one didn't work, it didn't stick. But my cousin, Eddie Elliott, came by our apartment one day. I had just lost a great job that God gave me with Prudential Insurance. I was a data entry specialist, had never even touched the computer. I went for a job interview. They were doing 3 phases of interview. They gave me the job that day. Put me in a department full of all women. God was trying to show me something. Next thing you know, I'm in the Red Roof Inn doing some stuff I got no business doing. Lost that job. I'm laying on the couch. And I utter these words because I didn't know any better. I didn't have any Bible. I was in a church that was just hollering and screaming. There was no teaching. So I'm laying on the couch and I uttered these words. Well, I don't want to be a hypocrite, so I'm going to stop being a Christian because I didn't have any Bible. I thought I could stop. Just then the doorbell rang. It was my cousin Eddie Elliott. Eddie Elliott came upstairs. He said, "Man, I heard you got saved. And I just came to fellowship with you." And he sat down and he opened up the pages. He opened up the pages of the Bible. And for the first time, somebody showed me from the Word of God. We spent the whole afternoon, we went line by line through the book of Galatians and the book of Ephesians. And I discovered from Scripture, that's why I use so many scriptures. I discovered from Scripture who I was. And what the basis of my salvation was secured in. And that even though I was up, down, in, out, over, under, it didn't affect the certainty of my salvation. Now, the challenge was to move from immaturity and playing with sin onto maturity so that the purpose God saved me for in the first place could be fulfilled. Because you could be saved, but if you keep dabbling with it, you'll never grow. And if you'll never grow, you'll never fulfill your purpose. And if you never fulfill your purpose, you'll never have satisfaction. And if you never have satisfaction, Christianity won't be for you what God intended for it to be. And then one day you'll stand before Jesus and he'll ask what you do. And you say, "I don't." Yet God in his grace freely makes us right in his sight. See, in God's sight. Even though I was doing all that crazy stuff, in his sight, he saw me washed and cleansed and redeemed in the blood. Everybody else will look at you and have all their opinions about you. But if the basis of your acceptance, the basis of your approach is on the fact that you admit and that you recognize that you can't measure up to God, therefore you are a sinner, and that keeping the rules can never make you right, you're a candidate of his mercy and his grace. And like the tax collector, you walk away justified. Watch this. Verse 25. "For God presented Jesus as the sacrifice for our sin." Some of your King James translation says as the propitiation. I love that word. I love that word, propitiation. Because that word in its original language means the satisfying act. That God presented Jesus as the satisfying act for sin. In other words, Jesus' perfect sinless life, his death, his burial, and his resurrection satisfied God's righteous demand for sin. You ever have a sweet tooth? I was at that wedding on Friday, Susan. I couldn't stay till they cut the cake. And I left and I had a sweet tooth. And we ended up driving around trying to find some store open 9:30 at night so I could satisfy that sweet tooth. And we found this nice little Indian restaurant, and I got some mango cake, I got some tiramisu cake, and I got some butternut scotch cake. And I got back to the hotel room, and I forgot to get a fork. So I went ghetto on them. I ripped off a piece of the cardboard of the box, scooped that bad boy up. And when I took that first bite, my craving, that sweet tooth was propitiated. It was satisfied. I said, I am fulfilled. I got what I wanted. Oh, that's what I've been looking for. That's the same way God looks at what Jesus did. His life, his death, his burial, his resurrection. That is what satisfies God's demand for sin. Nothing else you and I can do can bring satisfaction to God as relates to the issue of us not being like him. So stop trying and start trusting. Stop trying and start trusting. People are made right with God when they believe that Jesus sacrificed his life, shedding his blood. I trust that. Nothing else. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Amen. Go ahead, Pastor. Tell them.
It's the basis of our ability to be accepted. The tax collector understood that it was God's mercy that was the antidote for his sin. The Pharisee thought his works, his effort, earned him acceptance with God. The tax collector, though sinner that he was, he acknowledged and recognized his sin and pleaded and cried out to God for the only remedy for that sin, mercy. God tells us that mercy is embodied in the person, life, death, burial, and resurrection of his son, Jesus. And that if we would be like that tax collector and just simply cry out to God, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I am in need of what Christ offers. I am broken. I am deficient. I ain't right. Can't get right. Remember that movie Going Up to Heaven with Martin Lawrence and Eddie Murphy? The baseball player can't get right. That's all of us. Can't get right. Don't allow religiosity to deceive you in thinking that you've arrived somewhere that you have not. We can't get right. We can't measure up. Doesn't mean we don't pursue. Doesn't mean we don't strive. Doesn't mean that we just yield and give in to sin, because it will rob and destroy you of everything God has for you. And in robbing you, others will be robbed. What would have happened if I'd have never been able to overcome my addiction? We wouldn't be here. I leave you with this. Luke 18:14, how Jesus closed it out. He says, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. The Pharisee and the tax collector were figurative of typical attitudes that are common even in our age today. One man was full of pride and was quite self-righteous. The other was humble. He recognized his sins and he asked for God's mercy and was justified. The question is, which one are you?